Hello everyone and welcome on into the next video in Survey. So in the last video we had a little overview of the nervous system, and now in this video we're going to go into details on the structure of the communicating cells in the nervous system, the neurons. And then in the following video, the one after this one, we're going to be going over an action potential. So to understand an action potential, we have to understand the structure and function of a neuron. Let me switch to red here. You all know I like red by now. So the structure and function of a neuron, and then we'll briefly mention there are more than one type of neuron. There are three types of neurons, and we'll be able to identify those and where we can find them as well. All right. So getting right into it, the structure of a specifically one type of neuron called a multipolar neuron. A multipolar neuron has all its receptive endings at one end, and they all get summated in this area right here called the cell body. This is where the nucleus is, also known as the soma. So this is the cell body of a neuron, and it brings in all that information from the receptive endings called the dendrites. So all these structures out here, they could be branched, are called the dendrites. These dendritic endings can have unique appearances in different parts of the body as well. We're just looking at some generic representations here. So over here, and slightly grayed out, we have another neuron that would be coming in here, maybe communicating with this one. Sending its signal, and usually you have these dendritic receptive endings here at the terminals of the previous neuron that are then summating the signal right here onto this one. And then those signals, if they reach threshold, which we'll go over what threshold is in the next video, then fire what's called an action potential, then it travels down this structure here called an axon, runs all the way down that axon, and then goes to these axon terminals, and then synapse with maybe the next neuron, or maybe it could synapse with your muscle at the neuromuscular junction and lead to that muscle contraction. Now, a few things to talk about here. Here, there's a cell labeled called an oligodendrocyte. So the OpenStax book decided to use an oligodendrocyte here rather than something called a Schwann cell. Oligodendrocytes are found in the central nervous system. Schwann cells are found in the peripheral nervous system. So we talked about the difference between central and peripheral in the last video. So what these do is they produce a substance called myelin. Myelin is this, think of it as like the rubber insulation on a cable, electrical cable. It protects the axon. The axon is the long part that comes out here and then releases neurotransmitter down here at the terminals. So in the central nervous system, these oligodendrocytes, the cell body, would be located over here. Well, the nuclei, not the cell body. And then they come out and they can wrap up to like 20 to 50 axons. So you can have some over here wrapping around axons, some over here and so forth. Can wrap around multiple axons on different neurons. And that's, these oligodendrocytes are one example as to why the central nervous system is not regenerative, whereas a peripheral nervous system here does have some regenerative capability to it. It's because these Schwann cells, every individual node would be its own Schwann cell with a nucleus on it. There'd be a, I'll show down here when we go over this model image, you'll see what I mean. And so there are a lot more, and they can form these little protective tubes so for the new axon to grow and to sprout. And so that's one reason why your peripheral nervous system has some slightly regenerative capability to it. But this myelin sheath is, so if we have the axon in the middle, this myelin just kind of wraps around that axon, forming these dense layers of insulation, pretty much. And then we have these little gaps. These gaps are, you know, formerly known as the nodes of Ranvier. Ranvier was a scientist who studied them. And also, now we can call them the myelin sheath gaps as well. Same thing in the cell body here. It's not shown on this image, but there should be some purple stained substances in here as well. That is the rough ER in terms of which organelle it is. In the neurons, it's called the chromatophilic substance, or the guy who just studied it, some German scientists named Nissl. They're also known as the Nissl substance or Nissl bodies. And we can also see those purple stains down here as well in this neuron. So those would be the Nissl bodies or the chromatophilic substance. I'll just write Nissl right there to get it labeled. So that's just this textbook representation of a neuron. Down here, we have an actual lab model that I took an image of. Again, we have the nucleus right here. So that would be where the cell body is. That's the nucleus of the neuron. Here would be the cell membrane of it, sometimes referred to as the neurolemma. And then again, here is that chromatophilic substance or those nissl bodies. Here would be the dendrites coming out. They could have multiple branches on them as well. And then here would be where another neuron is communicating. These are all axon terminals forming synapses here. So this would then come out from another neuron communicating down in. So here these would all be sending their signal in and summating that information on this cell body right here. Then when all that information comes in and an action potential decides to be sent, when it hits the right conditions, it goes to this little structure right here called the axon hillock. And then it becomes the axon. The axon is in right here, and then axons can be very long, and then that continues down right here and then down through. So here's the cross section, and here you can see those layers of myelin layers coming in here. And this would be the nucleus of the Schwann cell right there, will be labeled over here. These would be the myelin layers right there. And right here would be that node of Ranvier or the myelin sheath gap. Inside the axon, you're transporting neurotransmitters, you're transporting mitochondria, that's what are labeled right here. And they're being sent either toward the axon terminal or away from the axon terminal. Those are retrograde or anterograde motion. You don't have to worry too much about those in this course though. So here it's shown there's one Schwann cell, there's one, and then over here would be another. There's a connective tissue around all neurons called the endoneurium. And then also if you look at a nerve, they then have a perineurium and an epineurium as well. Now, why is this myelination here? Well, it, one, protects the axons and also increases the speed of conductance. So the more heavily myelinated an axon is, the faster it can send that signal. So you have heavily myelinated, lightly myelinated, and non-myelinated fibers. These heavily myelinated fibers here can go like 300 miles per hour, and the non-myelinated ones go like 3 miles an hour, which is still pretty fast considering that's happening inside your body, but not as fast as 300. So this degree of myelination plays a big part here. And that was that difference between gray matter and white matter, if you recall. So that's the little the model representation of a neuron. And this is a multipolar neuron. There are other types of neurons that exist. Here are those three types. So we just talked about this one here, multipolar neuron. Multipolar neuron brings all the sensory information here, it summates it, and then sends the signal down along axon, and then transmits the signal at the terminals here. Now, and these are also the most common ones, all your motor neurons and so forth are these multipolar ones. A lot of the neurons communicating in your brain are also these multipolar ones as well, and they're typically myelinated. Next up here are the unipolar ones. These ones, they get the receptive endings here. That signal then travels down the axon. One difference is the cell body then comes off like a little T here. And then here's the terminals down here where it sends the information. This is all of your sensory neurons, not all, but most of your sensory neurons. Like when you touch right here on your finger, that's firing, that's activating these dendrites here that are on little pressure receptors. That signal then fires all the way up your arm, goes to your spinal cord, and right before it enters your spinal cord, there's a cluster of cell bodies called the dorsal root ganglion, and that's where this structure is. And then it enters the spinal cord, and that's where it sends its information for whatever that sense might be. So dorsal root ganglion and all your sensory neurons are very common unipolar neurons here, and they are typically myelinated as well. And then a rare one here would be the bipolar neuron. The bipolar neuron only found in vision, so some in your retina for visual processing, and then also your olfactory system as well for smell. And so pretty much those are the only place. These are non-myelinated, or very short and small neurons, and they're just little short communication bridges between two other neurons. But we might talk about those again when we get to those special senses. So that's all I have in this video today. It would have been too much to go into in the next video where we're going to be going into an action potential, but it's very important we understand the structure of this neuron and how it has its myelination levels. And then when we get to an action potential, how that can change that speed of conductance and how these dendrites are bringing the signal in. And then that signal comes together and we reach this magic thing called threshold, which we'll talk about more in the next video. All right, that's all I have for this little short video here. Hope you enjoyed it. And like always, if you have questions, please let me know. Have a great rest of your day. Bye-bye.